graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Space Team Universe 4, Song of the Space Siren, by Barry J. Hutchison. Narrated by Phil Thron and performed by a full cast.
Dogan Mert was not, by any stretch of the imagination, a brave man. He wasn't technically a man at all, in fact. He was a Talpan, a race of wide-eyed humanoid, yet somewhat mole-like creatures who traditionally lived deep underground and smelled ever so faintly of kitty litter. Not content with spending the entirety of his adult life in a dark cave, or overly keen on the kitty litter thing, Dogan had struck out on his own, determined to make his way in the world. That had been several years ago. Of late, things had not been going well. Dogan looked down at the scrap of paper he clutched in his shaking hands, then up at the flickering neon sign above the door. His reading ability was low at the best of times, and a full third of the letters in the sign were in darkness, but he was pretty sure this was the place. He pushed open the door. Sweat and smoke and noise and movement all rushed out through the gap. He closed the door again, alarmed by the brutality of it all.
Do it, Dogan. Do it, Dogan.
It had become a sort of personal mantra of his over the years, and he called on it whenever fear threatened to thwart his attempts to better himself. Do It Dogan had even been his nickname for a while back in the caves, although it was usually said in mocking tones and followed swiftly by a sharp punch to the testicles. He had no nicknames now, of course. To have a nickname, first you needed a friend, or an enemy who knew you well enough. Dogan pushed the door all the way open, clenched his fists down at his sides, then stepped into the bar. Even before getting the measure of the place, Dogan knew he didn't approve. The Talpan were fiercely moral, and public venues where people got into fights, drank excessively, and did the sort of things the three-legged gentleman on stage was doing were very much frowned upon. Despite himself, Dogan looked more closely at the man on the stage and came to the conclusion that the third appendage wasn't actually a leg at all. Horrified, Dogan turned away, blinked several times to try to erase the images he'd just witnessed, then headed for one of the bar's empty booths.
Sorry. Pardon me. Can I just squeeze? Thanks.
He weaved his way through the crowds. He reached the dimly lit booth, only to find a hulking green figure lurking in the corner nursing a drink.
Oh, sorry. I didn't...
He smiled, hopefully, at the booth's occupant.
Would you mind?
The creature stared impassively at Dogan for several seconds, its eyes glassy and black. At last, it waved a clawed hand at the bench across the table, and Dogan slid gratefully onto the ripped and threadbare padding.
Thank you.
Dogan nestled into the shadows. The lizard creature nodded once, but said nothing. Now that he was out of the crowds, Dogan took a moment to scan the place. A horseshoe-shaped bar took up around a quarter of the floor space, with the raised stage over by the far wall taking up a much smaller chunk. Clearly, people came for the entertainment, but stayed for the booze. The lights were low, and while there were a few groups hanging out together, most of the clientele seemed to be in pairs or on their own. Dogan felt the lizard creature's eyes on him and smiled shakily.
I'm looking for someone. I was told I might find him here.
He glanced around the bar again, anxiously picking at his black fingernails.
I need his help. I am in trouble.
Dogan caught himself just in time. He regarded the green-skinned alien cautiously.
You're not with the Xandri, are you?
The creature shook its head slowly.
Zertex?
Dogan eyed up the exit.
Are you law enforcement? Because I'm not allowed to talk to them. The Xandri made that very clear.
The creature shook its head again.
And you have to tell me if I ask you. It's the law.
The creature shook its head again. Dogen nodded, relieved.
Oh, good. Good. I apologize. I had to ask, you understand?
The creature said nothing.
You understand.
Dogen rubbed the tabletop that stood between them, feeling every scratch with the pink, wrinkled skin of his fingertips.
The problem is, I do not know what he looks like.
He gazed out across the bar again. The genetically blessed young man had been joined on stage by two alarmingly supple women, and many of the bar's occupants had started to gravitate towards that end of the room.
Oh.
Dogen angled himself for a better view so that he could really disapprove if things went the way he thought they were probably going to go.
But I am in trouble, and I believe he can help me.
Dogen tore his eyes from the stage.
The Xandri. They want money from my business. In return, they have offered to protect it. It's a nasty part of town, they tell me. Wouldn't want anything to happen to you, they say.
The mole man's eyes moistened, and he lowered his head for a moment, composing himself.
I paid. For a long time, I paid. But now the cost has gone up, and I can no longer afford to do so. Besides, it is my business, my money, my hard work. Why should I pay these gangsters?
He banged a fist on the table. It very clearly hurt, but he tried not to let on. He glanced around nervously.
I just want someone to make the Xandri understand that I cannot be pushed around, that they cannot continue to do as they please.
Dogen's eyes swept the bar again, searching for someone he didn't know but on whom he'd pinned all his hopes.
I am told this man and his crew may help me. I was told he might be here. It appears my information was incorrect.
Dogen met the gaze of the lizard creature and had another attempt at a smile.
My apologies. None of this is your concern. Forgive me for bothering you.
As Dogen spoke, one of the alien's clawed hands fumbled at a spot halfway up its scaly throat. Dogen watched in amazement as the claws dug into the spongy flesh, then blinked in surprise as a square flap was peeled aside, revealing a sweat-soaked human face inside.
Holy shiz, it is funking hot in there!
The man grabbed for his glass, shut his eyes, then tossed his drink in his face.
Oh, yeah, that's the stuff. Wow. Oh, that's better.
I do not understand. Who are you? What are you?
Oh, yeah, forgot that bit. Sorry, name's Cal. Cal Carver.
The man in the suit gave a rubbery thumbs up.
And mister, you just hired the space team.
Cal swept the clawed hand across his face, wiping away his drink.
I mean, technically it's just space team, not the space team, but, well, there was this TV show where I came from, and every week the leader, Hannibal, would...
He shook his head. The rubbery lizard's head shook, too.
You know what? Doesn't matter. The main thing is, you've got a problem, no one else can help, and you found us.
Us?
The back of the bench behind Dogen shook as someone moved in the next booth over. A dented metal figure stepped into view. Cal looked the cyborg up and down.
Mech, I thought I told you to find a disguise.
I did.
He ducked a little and pointed to the top of his head.
A tiny hat. That's your disguise? A tiny hat?
I'm a 7 foot tall cyborg. What the fuck should I have disguised myself as?
I don't know, maybe a different 7 foot tall cyborg? One who isn't on a list of the galaxy's most wanted?
Dogen looked between Cal and Mech, his mouth hanging open. A sudden movement at the edge of the booth caught his attention, and he almost screamed when a wolf-like creature in a tightly fitting leather outfit slid onto the seat next to Cal.
Hey! He's the wrinkly pink guy.
Dogen.
The wrinkly pink guy silently added the please don't eat me part in his head.
Miz, why aren't you disguised either?
Cal turned to look the wolf woman up and down. Because of his costume, this wasn't easy, and it took several attempts before he could twist his body enough to let him see her properly.
I don't know. Seemed kind of lame. Besides, look at me. Blending in? Totally not my thing.
How hard would it have been to pop on a pair of glasses or something? You know, a fake nose, a mustache. You couldn't even give me a mustache?
Why are you disguised?
Because we're wanted by the government for a crime we didn't commit.
Cal caught the looks from Mech and Miz.
Okay. We're wanted by the government for a crime we did commit. A number of crimes, actually. Mainly abducting the president, ejecting him into space, and stealing an experimental ship, but it's a pretty big list.
Cal pointed a clawed finger at Dogan.
But we're not here to talk about us. We're here to talk about you.
He leaned across the table, but it made his costume ride up and forced his cheeks up into his eyes, so he leaned back again.
Tell us more about these Xandri guys, and more importantly, just where we might be able to find them.
Cal, Mech, and Miz stood in a darkened doorway, watching the building directly across the street. Cal had ditched the lizard costume in an alleyway behind the bar, and now wore the black shirt, cargo pants, and scuffed brown boots he'd picked up on their recent trip back to the bug-infected wasteland that was now the planet Earth.
So, if I had to say who was who...
Cal rubbed his hands together to drive away the cold.
I'd be Face, because, you know, I'm the smooth-talking one who always charms his way out of trouble. But, and here's the thing, I'd also be Hannibal, because I'm the leader.
Leader? You ain't the leader. We ain't got no leader.
Well, we do, obviously, and it's me. But that's okay, because you're B.A., and everyone loves B.A.
Cal patted Mech on the chest.
I ain't going on no plane, sucker. You know?
What is he talking about?
I have no fucking idea.
Lawrence Murdoch. Because they're both pilots, not because she's got undiagnosed PTSD or whatever Murdoch had. And Ms... Ms is the sexy werewolf lady they rarely spoke about.
He shoved his hands in his pockets and turned his attention back to the doorway across the road.
I mean, we're not exactly the same, but there are broad similarities, is the point I'm trying to make.
It had been over a month since Cal had been abducted from his prison cell and whisked into outer space. And while lots of it was all still new and exciting, there were a few parts which were already losing their novelty. Streets like this, for example. He knew he couldn't have seen this street before. They'd only arrived on the planet a few hours ago, and yet there was something tediously familiar about it. The shadowy nooks, the grimy windows, the flurries of litter tumbling along it on the whims of the breeze. There were streets just like it back on Earth. Streets you didn't walk down if you valued your wallet, your kneecaps, or your life. Cal had seen more than his fair share back on his home planet, and was amassing quite the collection on other worlds, too.
Think that's the place?
Mech tapped the screen on his forearm and scanned the doorway opposite.
Door's heavy. Reinforced. Take a tank to knock that thing down.
Can you do it?
Mech made his way across the street.
Just watch me.
Cal hurried to keep up, with Miz stalking along behind him.
Okay, so let's just go in there, throw our weight around a little. Well, your weight, mostly, and give them a warning. Let's try not to kill anyone this time, if we can avoid it. Mizette, I'm looking at you here.
Fine. But what if they deserve it?
If they genuinely deserve it, it's totally fine. But you said that last guy deserved it because he was wearing yellow pants.
He totally did deserve it.
Girl's got a point. Those were some nasty pants.
A car hovered past and Miz gave it the finger. Cal felt a swelling of pride that he'd taught her the gesture. They stepped onto the sidewalk and positioned themselves by the reinforced door.
We should have brought Lauren on this.
Cal drew a blaster pistol from the holster on his belt.
Why? So the two of you could hold hands?
How many times do I have to tell you? There's nothing going on between us.
Oh, please.
Miz jabbed a thumb towards the door and glowered at Mech.
Are you going to kick this thing down or not?
Get ready.
Mech adjusted the dial on his chest just a fraction, diverting additional power to his hydraulics. Then he raised a leg and thrust it out in front of him like a battering ram.
Oh, man, that was so BA.
He took cover behind Mech as the cyborg ducked through the doorway and stomped into the starkly gray hallway beyond. A fluorescent strip light flickered on the ceiling, sending shadows dancing over the gloss-painted walls.
Attention, the Xandri.
Cal spotted blood. It pooled on the vinyl flooring and dribbled down the walls. It dripped from the light fitting and seeped from below the door at the far end of the hall. And, perhaps most significantly of all, it oozed from the quivering, gelatinous remains of what had presumably once been a living creature, but was now nothing more than gristle and flesh. Cal's grip tightened on his blaster.
Hello?
He poked the fleshy lump with his shoe. He backed off a little and waited.
Nope. I think it's dead.
What do you... Of course it's fucking dead. Look at it.
Well, I don't know, do I?
Cal pointed to the bleeding meat.
I saw someone who looked almost exactly like that back on that last planet. The guy giving out the parking tickets, remember?
That was the planet before.
Whatever. My point is, how am I supposed to know it's dead if I don't gently kick it, say hello, and wait to see if it responds?
It's worse in there.
Miz nodded towards the door.
Worse? There's blood pouring from the ceiling, and I don't know, a funking hip lying on the floor. How can it be worse?
Miz met his gaze and held it.
Trust me, it's worse.
To Cal, the air tasted like pennies.
Fine. I'm sure it's nothing we can't handle. Let's go check it out.
Why? Let's just turn around and get back to the ship. Hey, this shit's right here. This ain't our problem.
Cal shook his head.
And you have the nerve to call yourself B.A. Baracus.
I don't. You call me that. I don't even know who that is. Come on, man. Where are you going?
Cal had about turned and now strode purposefully along the hallway, doing his best to look like the man in charge. This was marred slightly by him slipping in the blood puddle and skidding several feet along the corridor while waving his arms in a panicky flap. He stumbled the last couple of feet, then steadied himself against the doorframe.
Totally meant that.
Then he turned the handle, opened the door a fraction, and poked his head inside. A moment later, he took it back out again. He turned to Miz, all color draining from his face.
I take it back. It's way worse.
If Cal had been asked to describe the scene beyond the door in one word, he would have mumbled something high-pitched and incoherent before immediately throwing up in his mouth. Unlike the featureless hallway, this room had been decorated to excess. There were gold drapes over the barred and shuttered windows, a delicately intricate chandelier hanging from the patterned ceiling, and various sideboards cluttered with what Cal would describe as space antiques, were he not currently wrestling with the vomiting-in-mouth situation. Because worse than the decor, worse than the hideous wallpaper, the zigzag patterned carpet, and the enormous framed prints of alien dogs playing space pool was the gore. There were no body parts in this room, but Cal would almost have preferred it if there had been. You knew where you were with a body part. Admittedly, it was rarely anywhere good, but at least you knew. Instead, there was a general sort of lumpy red puree covering every surface. It clung to everything like crimson moss and reeked of things Cal was trying very hard not to think about in too much detail.
And in case you're wondering,
Mech indicated the mulchy, wet redness.
Also dead.
Maybe we should get out of here. This is... I don't know what this is, but I get the feeling it's not something we want to get caught up in.
What did I tell you? What did I say not 20 fucking seconds ago?
Yeah.
Cal spun on the spot.
Let's all just run back to the ship as fast as we can and agree never to speak of this again.
Miz's hand clamped around his forearm.
There's someone here.
Cal pointed to the red mush on the ceiling.
What? Besides?
Miz nodded. She raised her ears and flicked them as her eyes took in the room.
Heartbeat. In there.
Cal followed her gaze. Another door stood just to the right of one of the shuttered windows. It was, given the state of the rest of the room, remarkably clean, with only a few red dots marking the otherwise crisp white paintwork.
What kind of heartbeat?
Cal adjusted his grip on his gun.
What do you mean?
Well, you know, is it like a big boom, boom, boom elephant heartbeat? Or a brrr hummingbird heartbeat? Or what is it? How big a thing is in there, is what I'm asking. And is it going to come jumping out and bite my head off if I open the door?
Cal shook his head.
In fact, why am I the one opening the door? Mech, open the door.
Fuck you, man. I ain't opening the door.
Well, I'm not opening it.
Fine by me. I'm all for just turning around and getting out of here.
Mizette crossed the room in six big steps.
Here, look. I'll open the door.
Cal raised his blaster as Miz tore the door off its hinges. Through the now gaping doorway, they saw several coats, a plastic basket, and what looked, from where Cal was standing, to be an ironing board. And tucked in amongst it all was a woman. A girl, maybe. It was hard to tell with the cloth bag over her head. Between that, the ropes around her bare ankles, and the way her hands were pulled behind her back, Cal got the impression she hadn't put herself in there on purpose.
Is she dead?
No.
How can you tell? Kick her and say hello.
I can hear her heart beating.
Oh, yeah, gotcha.
He walked across the carpet and squatted down in front of the hostage.
Hey, miss? Are you okay? We're here to help. We're not going to hurt you. I'm going to take the bag off your head. Now, you might see an enormous wolf woman, but she's harmless. Mostly harmless, but she won't hurt you. We're the good guys.
The woman didn't resist when Cal's fingers brushed against her neck. The bag was tied on pretty tightly, and it took several seconds of fumbling before he could get the knot undone.
Okay. Bag coming off now. Please don't, you know, bite me or spit acid in my face or anything. Good guys, remember? Keep that in mind.
The bag was removed, revealing a shock of bright red hair. It had been cut in a way that suggested the girl had done it herself with a pair of blunt scissors and no available reflective surfaces. If the hairstyle was a statement, that statement was almost certainly, "I've recently lost a bet." She looked maybe 12 or 13 based on Earth ages. He'd discovered those didn't mean much out here in space. Miz, for example, was 6 years old, but part of a species that matured much faster than humans. But something about the girl told him she was young. Her skin was a pastel green, with hundreds of raised white bumps dotted like freckles across her nose and around her eyes. The eyes themselves were wide ovals with piercing blue irises and curved lashes the same color as her hair. A purple bruise flowered on one of her sharply defined cheekbones, and her dark green lips were swollen on one side. Her gaze flitted anxiously from Cal to Miz to Mech before returning to Cal again. She closed her mouth tightly, her body vibrating violently as tears rushed to fill her eyes.
Hey, shh, it's okay, it's okay.
Cal gestured to the restraints around her ankles.
Miz.
Mizette flashed her claws and the ropes fell away. The girl drew her knees up to her chest.
What's your name, sweetheart?
The girl didn't answer. She looked so terrified, Cal wasn't sure she'd even heard him. He backed away a little and gestured for her to shuffle towards him.
Come on, out you come. Just try not to look at the walls or carpet or, you know, anything else in the room.
Miz's ears flicked.
Sirens.
Zyrtex.
Miz listened, then shook her head.
Local cops, but 4 or 5 squads.
They're coming here. Somebody heard screaming and shooting. Called it in a few minutes ago.
Well, they're annoyingly efficient.
Cal straightened and motioned for the girl to stay where she was.
It's okay. The police are coming. They'll sort out this,
He looked around at the blood slush.
Whatever this is, and get you back home. We'd stick around, but, well, they might think we did this, and that would be problematic.
He gave her one of his best smiles, a lips-together, eyebrows-raised little number designed to make his face as comforting as possible, then backed towards the door.
You take care of yourself, okay? Stay in school, if, you know, that's a thing where you come from. Eat your vegetables, respect your parents. Try not to dwell too much on the whole being kidnapped and locked in a closet thing.
Cal, we need to go.
Cal nodded, but hesitated just inside the door. He met the frightened gaze of the girl among the coats.
You're safe, kid. You're going to be just fine.
Mech shoved him through the door and Cal skidded along the hall. He slid out onto the sidewalk and his boots immediately found their grip on the slabs, snapping him to a jerking stop.
Come on, we should go back to the ship.
Yeah, just one sec. Look over there.
Over where? What are you talking about?
Just funky look somewhere over there.
An eruption of vomit splattered across the ground.
Ugh, too late.
Oh man, that's nasty.
Like, ew, that totally stinks.
I tried to warn you.
Cal rubbed his stomach.
Oh, that does feel better though. I guess it's true what they say, better out than...
The girl peeked out from behind one of the broken doors.
Hey, you should go back inside.
The girl glanced back over her shoulder, then shook her head and stepped out onto the sidewalk. Cal put a hand on her upper arm. She flinched, but didn't quite pull away.
No, listen. Hear that? The police are coming. You'll be safe with them.
Shiz! Cal!
The street became a red and blue light show, and several wedge-shaped black vehicles skidded around the corner on cushions of air, or magnetism, or whatever alien science was keeping them hovering above the ground like that. The beam of a powerful spotlight hit Cal full in the face.
Jesus, that's bright. What is that, the funking sun?
He turned away from the light and realized he was still holding the girl by the arm. The handcuffed girl, with the bruises.
Oh, shit.
He pulled away.
That wasn't what it looked like. This has nothing to do with us, honest. We're the good guys in this situation.
Come on, man, this way.
Mech moved a few paces in the opposite direction. A heavy, rectangular armored vehicle rumbled around the corner, blocking the road that way, too. A set of double doors opened at the back, then a dozen or more black-clad figures jogged down a ramp and formed a line across the street from one side to the other. On some hidden signal, they all tapped switches on their left forearm, and a wall of crackling blue energy shields spread out from their wrists. Riot cops, Cal guessed. That wasn't good. Back on Earth, at least, riot cops weren't exactly renowned for their willingness to listen to reasoned debate. These guys didn't look like they'd be any different. The cars had come to a stop around 60 feet away from Cal and the others. The sides of all four vehicles swung upwards like the doors of an Italian sports car. Mech and Miz both tensed as eight more of the darkly dressed figures emerged. Where the riot cops had shields, this lot carried blaster rifles. Seven of them took cover behind the cars, while the eighth, the leader, presumably, stood his ground.
Just leave the talking to me.
Cal gestured in the direction of the cops.
I'll have this sorted out.
Cal ducked, clamping a hand to his ear. When he took it away, his palm was slicked with blood.
Jesus, my ear! They shot my ear! Why did you shoot my ear?
I don't know, maybe because you're waving a fucking gun at them?
Cal looked at the hand he'd pointed to the cops with. Sure enough, his blaster pistol was clutched in it. He quickly lowered the weapon and offered an apologetic smile.
Sorry, I didn't realize. I see how that might have looked.
Miz's ears twitched.
They're going to shoot us.
What? Why?
Guy and friends got an earpiece. Someone just gave the command.
Oh, fuck! Get behind me!
Before anyone could move, the girl stepped forwards, putting herself in front of Cal.
Hey, miss, you might want to get back inside. This isn't really the place for...
The girl opened her mouth. The lone cop in front of the cars flipped violently backwards, his head practically touching his heels as his body looped back on itself. The cars went next, rolling across the ground in a shower of shattering glass and a tangle of twisting metal. The other cops, the ones who had been taking cover behind the vehicles, became 7 explosively colorful stains on the tarmac, before those, too, were swept away as if in the path of a raging tsunami. The girl turned to Cal, who gawked at her as if she were an unexploded nuclear bomb.
What the fuck was that?
She just clamped her lips shut, then angled herself so her bound wrists were pointed towards Mizette. Miz looked to Cal. He deliberated briefly, then gave a nod.
Do it. Cut her loose.
He glanced in the other direction along the street, where the assembled members of the riot squad were advancing behind their shields.
Then get ready to run, because we are getting the funk out of here.
Miz bounded ahead, leading the way through the warren of back streets and alleyways. She heard sirens coming from several blocks away, smelled cops before they got too close. Sure, they had to duck behind the odd trash can and sprint across the occasional wide-open street, but the going had been pretty easy, considering. Cal would almost have felt relaxed were it not for the girl. She jogged along beside Mech, slowing down and speeding up in time with his mechanical steps. She kept her mouth shut the whole way, breathing through her slender nose as they navigated back to the landing pads. It took Cal a few moments to spot the ship. He was looking for the Shatner, but it had been destroyed after they plunged through an anomaly he'd come to think of as a big space hole. The new ship was better in pretty much every way, but Cal couldn't help missing the old one. The currently untitled, because Cal hadn't as yet come up with a name for it, stood dead ahead, sticking out like a sore thumb among the other ships around it. It was completely spotless. That was the problem. The other ships looked like they'd been around the galaxy a few times, and the untitled looked forecourt new by comparison. It was also, Cal was happy to report, the coolest looking of the ships around it. The others looked homemade at worst, boxy at best, but the untitled was a collection of sleek curves with a hull that was either black, gray, dark green, or a sort of chrome color, depending on how the light happened to be reflecting off it at the time.
So what, we're just leaving? What about our money?
What money?
You know, from the mole guy. He wanted us to stop them gangsters shaking him down. Well, I reckon they ain't gonna be shaking him down anytime soon. We should get paid.
Cal jabbed a thumb back the way they'd come.
So, you want to take credit for that, do you? You want to take credit for painting the inside of that house with people puree? With the cops looking for us?
I just think we should get paid is all.
Seriously? It was like 50 credits. If you care that much, I'll pay you myself.
And not the point. Ain't the point. It's the principle of the thing. We did a job. We should get paid.
But we didn't do the job, did we? We were going there to talk to those guys. Did any of us do that? Do you recall walking in there and saying, hey, please stop taking money from our friend? Oh, and by the way, did you know you're currently dripping from the ceiling?
Fine, whatever. But next time we're getting paid.
Good. Well, I'm glad that's sorted.
Cal turned to the girl.
Which just leaves you. And we are going to leave now, sweetheart. You should stay here, okay?
The girl didn't respond. Cal smiled.
Okay, she gets it. Come on.
He strode towards the untitled. The girl followed. He stopped.
No, you can't come with us.
He pointed to the girl, then the ground at her feet.
You stay. Capiche?
He strode towards the untitled again. The girl followed. Again.
Look, what part don't you...
A laser blast shot from the shadows at the far end of the street. It left a shimmering heat trail in its wake as it raced towards Cal's face, and the goofy expression of surprise currently plastered across it. Mech thrust up an arm in front of Cal's head and grimaced as the blast exploded against his wrist.
Ah! That actually hurt!
This is the police. Put down your weapons. This unit is authorized to use lethal force.
Something enormous emerged from the shadows. It looked like a cheap Chinese knockoff of one of the Transformers, and not one of the friendly ones. Each leg alone had to be 8 feet high, and the body that sat atop it looked to be part robot, part tank, and another part tank for good measure.
Mech.
What?
I think your dad's here.
Oh, shut the funk up.
A red and blue beacon began to flash way at the top of the towering robo-tank.
Aw, look, they gave it a little light on its head. Is it weird that I think that's kind of cute?
Repeat, this is the police. Put down your weapons. This unit is authorized to use lethal force.
Mech's fingers went to a button on his wrist.
Wait, you're not going to shoot at it, are you? No offense, Mech, but that thing could pick you up and use you like a toothpick.
Okay, one, I'd like to see it try. And two, no, I ain't gonna shoot at it. I'm opening the landing ramp.
Cal glanced over at the untitled just as a ramp lowered smoothly beneath it.
Ah, gotcha.
Okay, on my mark.
But Cal and Miz were already off and running.
They couldn't have waited 3 fucking seconds?
Mech raised his arm and pumped out a few laser rounds. They ricocheted harmlessly off the police robot's chest, but they got its attention. Mech beat a retreat towards the untitled as the tank opened fire. A blast slammed into his shoulder. Another tore into his thigh, staggering him in a shower of sparks.
Oh, shit!
The hydraulics in his left leg twitched and spasmed. He limped on. The ramp was less than 15 feet away, but a warning on the HUD behind his eyeballs suddenly flashed up in red.
Missile lock? Oh, fuck!
There was nothing he could do but cover his head with his hands, grit his metal bottom teeth against his organic top ones, and hope there was a cyborg heaven. A blaster turret burst into life right beside him. The missile erupted 100 feet behind Mech. He raised his head to see Cal standing at the bottom of the ramp, the turret hooked over his shoulder, his face a mask of excited glee as he sprayed 30 blasts of concentrated firepower a second time along the street.
Woohoo! This thing is awesome!
Despite the barrage of laser blasts currently slamming into its upper body, the tank cop advanced.
Hurry up, Mech! Get in!
Mech struggled forwards, moving onto the ramp just as the untitled's lift thrusters painted the underside of the ship in shades of brilliant blue. Miz caught Mech by the arm and helped him aboard. Cal backed towards the ramp, still raining blaster fire on the approaching mechanoid. He hopped on and released the trigger as the ramp raised and the ship lurched into the air. Cal unhooked the turret from his shoulder and blew on his hands. Even through the grips on the handles, the metal had become uncomfortably hot.
Ah, remind me to wear gloves next time.
And that was when he spotted the girl. She stood behind Mech, half hidden by his hulking frame.
Wait, why is she here? You're not supposed to be here.
Guys, get up here. We've got a problem.
Well, isn't that a surprise? Surely even she can't have crashed already?
Cal pointed to the girl.
You, follow me. We'll drop you off somewhere once we're out of whatever mess we're currently in. But for now, just don't touch anything.
On the bridge, Tila Lauren sat at a horseshoe-shaped bank of controls, gazing grimly at the star-filled sky ahead. Miz flopped down and slouched into her chair, while Mech took up his usual standing position to the right of the view screen and activated the magnets in his feet. His damaged left leg fizzled and spat angry-looking sparks onto the floor around him. Lauren glanced at the leg just briefly, then turned her attention back to the screen. Cal noticed the look.
You think that's bad? Check out my ear.
He bent beside Lauren and pointed to the side of his head.
What about it?
I got shot.
Lauren turned back to the screen.
Looks fine.
Cal felt his ear. It seemed to be intact, and the blood was no longer flowing.
Huh, that's weird.
He turned to the girl, then pointed to a row of 3 chairs fixed to the bridge's back wall.
You, sit there.
And I'd put on your seatbelt if I were you. We've got
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.